So operator precedence grammar is basically, it is a type of grammar that is used to define the relations and the precedence in a compiler for mathematical operators. So there are a few rules for operator precedence grammar. For example, no two non-terminals can be adjacent, and non-terminals have to produce something. So no RHS of any production has null, and it is a kind of a shift-reduced parsing grammar. So it is applied to a small class of operator grammar. So obviously, because no two non-terminals are adjacent and no production has epsilon, so which means that not every grammar can be derived, can be made into an operator precedence grammar. So it is what it is. And this next one,
this is an example of operator precedence grammar. As Kriti said that in operator precedence grammar, this is an example of operator grammar. As Kriti earlier said that the we will say a grammar is operator precedent when no epsilon is in right side and no adjacent variable in the grammar, but there can be a terminal and non-terminal aside. Here is the grammar that have shown that E produces E plus E or E star E and I D. Here we can see that E and E are two non-terminal, and in between there is a operator grammar. The main rule to be a grammar is operator precedence is there is no epsilon in right hand side and no adjacent variable in grammar. See here that E produces E plus E or E star E and ID. Here E plus E are two non-terminal, and in between them there is a operator, as well as E star E star is an operator and ID also. However, the grammar given below is not an operator grammar, because in this grammar S produces S AS. Here is adjacent, so we will not say this grammar is operator precedence grammar. And as well as in the below, the A produces B S B or B. Here also the same case as I mentioned above, and we can convert it into an operator grammar. Though here S produces S B S B S. Here S is a non-terminal, and B also B is a terminal, so there is no problem. And next S B S, here in between S there is a B is a terminal and A also a terminal, so it is considered that it is a operator precedence grammar. And A produces B S B and B, so it is called operator precedence grammar. And mainly we have an aim to draw a parse tree where the operator grammar is send the grammar to the parser, and operator parser will take the input and draw a parse tree. The sum up rule is made by the first rule is check this grammar is operator grammar or not. Secondly, operator precedence relation table, we have to draw a operator precedence relation table where there is a four column that consists stack, first stack, then relation, thirdly input, and fourthly comment. And third rule, parse the given string. Here we can see E produces E plus E star E ID. We have to parse this string and generate parse tree. In the question, there also be given an input string which we have to parse, and after that we will draw a parse tree. Then we have to in this way we will have to complete this tree.
We'll discuss the operator precedence grammar. First of all, we need to know that what is operator precedence parser. An operator precedence parser is a bottom-up parser that interrupts an operator grammar. This parser is only used for operator grammar. Ambiguous grammar are not allowed in any parser except operator precedence parser. There are two methods for determining what precedence relations should hold between a pair of terminals. First is, use the conventional associativity and precedence of operator. The second is, precedence relations is first to construct an unambiguous grammar for the language. A grammar that reflects precedence parser use precedence function that map terminal symbol to integers, and the precedence relation between the symbol are implemented by numerical comparison. This is the operator precedence parser. Next, I will request to Apurva Pradhan for discuss the precedence relations.
As we can see in this slide about precedence relation, and the precedence relations are defined using the following rules. Rule number one, if precedence of B is higher than precedence of A, then we define A less than B. If precedence of B is same as precedence of A, then we define A equal to B. If precedence of B is lower than precedence of A, then we define A greater than B. Rule number two, an identifier is always given the higher precedence than any other symbol. Dollar symbol is always given the lowest precedence. Rule number three, if two operators have the same precedence, then we go by the checking their associativity.
I will discuss the advantages of the operator precedence grammar. And so first is the it can easily be constructed by hand, and the second one is it is simple to implement this type of parsing. So besides these advantages, there is some disadvantages also. So first one is that it is hard to handle tokens like the minus sign, which has two different precedents depending on whether it is unary or binary. And the second one is that it is applicable only to a small class of grammars. Which one of the following statements about the parser is or are correct? So CLR is more powerful than SLR, or CLR is more powerful than LR, or SLR is more powerful than CLR. So here are four options. Now I will discuss the answer. So here is a diagram that from this diagram we can see that SLR is a LR0 is a subset of SLR, and SLR is a subset of LLR, and LLR is a subset of CLR. So CLR is more powerful. In SLR method, we work with the LR0 items, whereas in CLR, we work with the LR1 items. So LR1 item is comprised of two parts. One is the LR0 item and other one is the look ahead, which is associated with the item. So if we work with the LR1 items instead of using LR0 items, then every state of the parser corresponds to a set of LR1 items. So when the parser look ahead in the input buffer to decide whether the reduction is to be done or not, the information about the terminals is available in the state of the parser itself, which is not in case of SLR parser state. So that's why CLR is more powerful. So here is a relation that CLR is greater than LLR, greater than SLR, greater than LR0. So from this relation, we can easily say that option A is only the correct option, which is CLR is more powerful.
The question is, which one of the following kinds of derivation is used by LR parser? Four options are there. Option A, leftmost. Option B, leftmost in reverse. Option C, rightmost. Option D, rightmost in reverse. Next slide, please. The correct answer is option D, that is rightmost in reverse, because parsing is classified into two categories. First is top-down parsing and another is bottom-up parsing. Top-down parsing is based on leftmost derivation, whereas bottom-up parsing is dependent on reverse rightmost derivation. A general sift-reduced parsing is LR parsing. It's bottom-up parsing, where L stands for scanning the input from left to right and R stands for constructing a rightmost derivation in reverse. Therefore, the option D, that is the rightmost in reverse, is the correct answer. Next question will discuss by above comment.
So, in a bottom-up evaluation of a syntax-directed definition, inherited attributes can always be evaluated. Be evaluated only if the definition is L-attributed. Be evaluated only if the definition has synthesized attributes, and never be evaluated. So the correct answer will be B. That is, be evaluated only if the definition is L-attributed. Because a syntax-directed definition is called as attributed if it has only synthesized attributes. L-attributed definition contain both synthesized and inherited attributes, but do not need to build a option B is correct. And the next,
when a grammar S gives a capital S, capital B or D, and capital B gives B. So we have a given input string, so a small d b b b. So we have to find out how many reduction steps bottom up parser will take to actually accept this string. So first of all, we convert the middle d into s using the given s gives d. So let me show you the slide. So first of all, we convert the middle D into S, and then the B after S to capital B using the B gives B rule. So now we have A capital S capital B, and S gives small a capital S capital B. So now we have reduced the string in number 3 to AA SBB. Now using the same trick twice, that is the same trick, B to capital B, and then convert using that A is B, and then again B to B, and then A is B. We can see that we have used 7 steps using bottom up parsing to accept the strings. So option B is correct. Option B was 7.
Question is, the grammar S produces A capital S A or B capital S and C. Then the options are LL1 but not LR1, LR1 but not LR1, both LL1 and LR1, and neither LL1 or LR1. And the correct answer is option C, both LL1 and LR1. Now, the discussion is, first of all, we have to find the first of A capital S A. So the first of A capital S A is a small a. This is a terminal. Then first of B is capital S is B, small b, and first of C is C. All are mutually disjoint, so no common terminal between them. The given grammar is LL1. As the given grammar is LL1, so it will also be LR1, as LR parser are more powerful than LL1 parsers. And all LL1 grammar are the also LR1 grammar. So we can easily say that the option C is correct, the both LL1 and LR1. This grammar is both LL1 and LR1. Is obviously the proposed algorithm will help in compiler writing. It is already mentioned that there is no existing efficient generalized algorithm to our best knowledge for parsing operator grammar with unary operators. It's completely a new idea in parsing unary grammar. it is very easy to understand to implement. It parser string efficiently and correctly. The complexity is similar to the Bayesian algorithm and it is in O of N. However, the functionality of that algorithm is machine dependent, so it can be a nice choice to the compiler writer and the code generator to parse the unary operators.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. A very good presentation. It's a very good operator precedence. You have gone very details. Thank you, everybody. Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.